Hello friends, welcome to my channel. This is Abhirami and I am here to discuss with you about today's topic, that is the introduction to thorax. So there are four subparts here, that is the trunk of our body, skeleton of thorax, shape of thorax and clinical anatomy. So first let's talk about the trunk of our body. So this diagram shows the trunk of our body. The trunk is present below the neck and the trunk is divided into upper part called the thorax and the lower part called the abdomen by a diaphragm. Now let's talk about the thorax. The thorax provides shelter not only for the thoracic viscerae but also some of the abdominal viscerae, and the thorax is supported by a skeletal framework called the thoracic cage, and inside the thoracic cage we have the thoracic cavity, and the thoracic cavity holds the primary organs for respiration and circulation, that is the heart and lungs. Now let's talk about the skeleton of the thorax. So as I already mentioned, the skeleton of the thorax is the thoracic cage. A part of it is shown here. The vertebral column is not shown, but the ribs and the sternum is shown. This is the manubrium. Manubrium is also a part of the sternum. And this is the sternum. So between the manubrium and the sternum, we have the manubriosternal joint. And this is the xiphoid process. Okay, so this is the first rib. And likewise, the other ribs are also present here. Okay, so now let's talk about this in detail. All the ribs are connected posteriorly to the vertebral column, and first seven ribs are connected anteriorly to the sternum through their costal cartilages. Okay, the dashed part is the cartilage. So the first seven ribs connect themselves to the sternum anteriorly through their costal cartilages. So they are called as vertebrosternal ribs or the two ribs because they attach themselves to the vertebral column posteriorly and the sternum anteriorly. Okay, so the next three pair of ribs, that is the 8th, 9th and 10th, are present over here, 8, 9 and 10. And these ribs attach themselves to the higher cartilages, okay, the upper ones. So they attach themselves to the upper cartilages. So, and they attach themselves posteriorly to the vertebral column. So they are also called as the vertebrochondral ribs, okay. And the 7th rib, 8th rib and 9th rib and 10th rib, all four form the costal margin. As I mentioned over here, so this is the costal margin. Okay, the 11th and the 12th rib are free anteriorly, and posteriorly they attach to the vertebral column. So these ribs are called as the vertebral ribs or the floating ribs. And we call the vertebrochondral ribs and the vertebral ribs as the false ribs because they do not attach themselves to the sternum anteriorly. So the manubriosternal joint present over here, and then the chondrosternal joint present over here, and then the costovertebral joints all together help in the movements of the thoracic cavity during breathing. Now let's talk about the shape of the thorax. So the shape of the thorax is a truncated cone. Truncated cone means the top of the cone is cut off. So the shape of the thorax is a truncated cone, which is narrow in the upper part and larger in the lower part. Okay, so now let's talk about the upper part and lower part separately. The upper part of the thorax is continuous with the root of the neck as shown over here, and it is partially separated from the neck by the suprapleural membrane or the Stimson's membrane. Now let's talk about the lower part of the thorax. So the lower part of the thorax is nearly completely separated from the abdomen by the diaphragm, which is concave from the downwards. So concave from the downwards, okay. And usually thorax is seen as large, but it is actually very small because the upper part is seen as large because of the shoulders which are broad. The lower part is not so large because the abdomen takes most of the space in the thorax because the diaphragm is concave. Now let's talk about the transverse section of the thorax. So the transverse section of the thorax is actually reniform. Reniform means bean shaped or kidney shaped. So you can remember it like this because reniform is kidney shaped or bean shaped, and you can remember the reniform word through this because kidney is related to renal and both of them start with ren. Okay, so in the transverse section of the adult thorax, the transverse diameter is greater than the anterior posterior diameter. So this diameter is greater than the anterior posterior diameter. Okay. And in the infants, that is below 2 years old, the shape of the thorax in the transverse section is circular. Okay. And in quadrupeds, the shape of the thorax is like a heart shape. So this is how the transverse section of thorax looks in quadrupeds. And here the anterior-posterior border is larger than the transverse diameter. Okay, the anterior-posterior diameter is larger than the transverse diameter. Now let's talk about the difference in the respiration of the infants and the adults. So in the infants, the ribs were horizontal. So as a result, it was purely abdominal respiration for them. Because of the abdominal movements, the diaphragm went up and down and thus respiration took place. In adults, the thorax is oval and the ribs were oblique, and because of this, inspiration and expiration took place because of the movement of the ribs. This is called the thoracic respiration. So in adults, both the thoracic respiration and the abdominal respiration exists. But in infants, only the abdominal respiration exists. Now let's talk about the clinical anatomy. So there are three main things we should focus on here. The first is the fracture. In adults, the fracture of the upper two ribs is less common because it is protected by the clavicle, and the fracture of the last two ribs, that is 11 and 12, is also less common. The fracture of the ribs may occur due to a direct violence or indirect violence. If it is because of an indirect violence, then the fracture of the rib occurs at the weakest point, that is at the angle of the rib. The second thing is a cervical rib. A cervical rib means a rib that is attached to the C7 part of the thoracic vertebrae. It means it is overlying the lower trunk of the brachial plexus and it is exerting pressure on it. And this leads to paraesthesia. It is abnormal sensation in the ulna side of the forearm. So this is the ulna side of the forearm. It leads to abnormal sensation in the ulna side of the forearm. And it also leads to wasting of the small muscles in the hand, which are supplied by the segment T1. This may also cause vascular changes. So the last part is the coarctation of the aorta or the narrowing of the aorta, which may happen due to the deposition of cholesterol, and this leads to the enlargement of the posterior intercostal vessels, arteries, so that it can provide a collateral circulation. And because of the enlargement of the posterior intercostal arteries, let's say it's a rib, it causes the notching of the rib. Notching of the rib means the rib forms a depression at the part where it is in contact with the artery because the artery gets enlarged. This can be seen on the radiological examination. Thank you. That is the end of the session. And if you have doubts in the Bones of the Upper Limb Chapter 2, you can visit my previous videos. And if you like this video, please like, share and subscribe it. Thank you.